Welcome to another presentation about the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. The elliptical geometry and the uniform alignment of the Carolina Bays started a rivalry between the proponents of an impact origin of the bays and proponents of uniformitarian terrestrial processes. Back in the 1930s and 1940s, the discussions were professional and respectful. Each side criticized only the hypothesis of the opponents, pointing out the deficiencies and offering alternative proposals. However, since the publication of the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis in 2007, the discussions have degenerated into a cosmic brawl where scientists are insulted and accused of incompetence. The opponents of the impact hypothesis completely reject the idea of an impact and try to explain all the observations by ordinary terrestrial processes. The conflict has created a toxic atmosphere that has left many scientists with resentments and bruised egos. The source of contention is a paper published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in 2007 with the title Evidence for an Extraterrestrial Impact 12,900 Years Ago that Contributed to the Megafaunal Extinctions and the Younger Dryas Cooling by Richard Firestone and 25 co-authors. This paper established what became known as the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis, or YDIH. As proof of the extraterrestrial impact, the paper mentioned that many Clovis Age sites in North America are overlain by a thin, discrete layer with varying abundances of magnetic grains with iridium, magnetic microspherules, charcoal, soot, carbon spherules, and glass-like carbon-containing nanodiamonds. The paper proposed that one or more large, low-density extraterrestrial objects exploded over northern North America, partially destabilizing the Laurentide ice sheet and triggering the Younger Dryas cooling. The shockwave, thermal pulse, and event-related environmental effects, such as extensive biomass burning and food limitations, contributed to the end Pleistocene megafaunal extinctions. In the 1960s, Eugene Shoemaker investigated meteor crater in Arizona and developed criteria for distinguishing impact craters from volcanic calderas and other structures created by terrestrial mechanisms. Impacts have overturned flaps around the crater, and the presence of shocked quartz crystals provides evidence of the great pressure from the impact. Firestone's paper did not provide the location of a crater or evidence of shocked quartz. In 2011, Nicholas Painter and six other university professors wrote a paper titled The Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis, a Requiem. The paper rejected the hypothesis by saying that all the physical evidence interpreted as signatures of an impact event consists of evidence that has been largely rejected by the scientific community and is no longer in widespread discussion. A requiem is a religious ceremony for the dead, so from the outset, these professors were declaring the death of the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis. Painter's paper says that recent studies have shown that carbon spheres and elongates do not represent extraterrestrial carbon nor impact-induced megafires, but are indistinguishable from fungal sclerotia and arthropod fecal material that are small but common components of many terrestrial deposits. The paper also says that in all these cases, sparse but ubiquitous materials seem to have been misreported and misinterpreted as singular peaks at the onset of the Younger Dryas. The accusation of misreporting implies dishonesty of the scientists, and the accusation of misinterpretation implies incompetence or ignorance. It is one thing to reject the hypothesis because it does not meet some technical requirements, but it is another thing to say that the authors of the hypothesis are dishonest, incompetent, or ignorant. The journal editors did a bad job by letting this ad hominem statement get published. The proponents of the impact hypothesis, called the Comet Research Group, were not discouraged by the negative comments and continued providing evidence of the worldwide distribution of impact spherules. They also provided evidence of extraordinary biomass burning triggered by the proposed cosmic impact 12,800 years ago. Mark Boslow, a physicist at Sandia National Laboratories, and 15 co-authors provided additional objections to the Younger Dryas impact event. One of the arguments against the impact was that the odds of the impact of a comet with a diameter greater than 4 kilometers at the specified time period were infinitesimal, or about 1 in 10 to the 15th power, which is 1 in 1 quadrillion. The evidence against an extraterrestrial impact mentioned in this paper is the lack of impact craters, the misinterpretation of data, and the inability to reproduce the reported results. Mikhail Petayev, working with three co-authors, examined an ice core from Greenland. The group was expecting to put the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis to rest by showing that 12,800 years ago, the levels of sphalerophile elements did not spike, but instead they found a peak in platinum that they attributed to an iridium-poor iron meteorite that was unlikely to result in an airburst or trigger wide wildfires proposed by the YD Impact Hypothesis. In trying to disprove the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis, these scientists found evidence to support an impact. Mark Boslow, who had argued that the chance of an impact at the time of the Younger Dryas was infinitesimal, objected to the idea that the platinum anomaly was associated with the cataclysm and proposed that the platinum anomaly could be the result of a local, non-cataclysmic event such as the entry of the Cape York meteorite, which is an iron meteorite from western Greenland with a total recovered weight of 58.2 tons. Petaev and his co-authors defended their results and said that the controversy about the scale of the platinum depositing event could only be resolved by additional analysis of other localities worldwide. Christopher Moore and 10 members of the Comet Research Group analyzed 11 widely separated archaeological sedimentary sequences and found that the platinum anomaly was distributed across North America at the Younger Dryas boundary. The paper suggested that the layer containing platinum can be used as a time marker horizon for identifying and correlating archaeological sequences. A paper by Todd Surabel and 8 co-authors conducted an independent analysis of magnetic minerals and microspherules from 7 sites of similar age, including 2 examined by Firestone. These scientists were unable to reproduce any results of the 2007 Firestone study. Therefore, they could find no support for the Younger Dryas extraterrestrial impact. A paper published 13 years later by James Lawrence Powell explains that soon after the 2007 publication by Firestone, a few scientists reported that they were unable to replicate the critical evidence about the microspherules. The scientific community reacted by rejecting the Younger Dryas impact hypothesis, but today, many independent studies have reproduced that evidence at dozens of sites. A paper available online in 2023 claims to provide a comprehensive refutation of the Younger Dryas impact hypothesis. The co-authors include Mark Boslow, who has consistently opposed the impact hypothesis, and Mikhail Petaev, who found the platinum anomaly at the Younger Dryas boundary in the course of the Greenland ice sheet. These two scientists who opposed each other have now united against the Younger Dryas impact hypothesis. This paper repeats many of the arguments that were published in the 2011 Requiem paper about the impact hypothesis that refuses to die. As of October 2023, this paper is in press, available as a journal preproof, waiting for final revisions. There are many more examples of this bitter debate that has lasted 16 years. We need to step back to get an overview of the arguments for and against the impact hypothesis. In carefully designed scientific experiments, even null results can be evidence of absence. For instance, a hypothesis may be falsified if a vital predicted observation is not found empirically. At this point, the underlying hypothesis may be rejected or revised, and sometimes additional ad hoc explanations may even be warranted. Whether the scientific community will accept a null result as evidence of absence depends on many factors, including the detection power of the applied methods, the confidence of the inference, as well as confirmation bias within the community. The inability of Surabel's evaluation to find microspherules was eventually traced to a failure to follow exactly the procedure specified in Firestone's paper. Argument from ignorance, also known as appeal to ignorance, in which ignorance represents a lack of contrary evidence, is a fallacy in informal logic. It asserts that a proposition is true because it has not yet been proven false, or a proposition is false because it has not yet been proven true. This represents a type of false dichotomy in that it excludes the possibility that there may have been an insufficient investigation to prove that the proposition is either true or false. It also does not allow for the possibility that the answer is unknowable, only knowable in the future, or neither completely true nor completely false. In debates, appealing to ignorance is sometimes an attempt to shift the burden of proof. Proponents of the Younger Dryas impact hypothesis state that there was an impact because it explains a megafaunal extinction, extensive fires, a global cooling event, a platinum anomaly, and impact microspherules. Opponents of the hypothesis say that there was no impact because the evidence presented for an impact is not convincing. The only real evidence would be an impact crater and shocked quartz. This impasse can only be overcome with additional evidence of an impact. Although opponents of the impact hypothesis demand a crater and shock quartz, there is another characteristic of impacts that may provide support for the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis. The 1989 book by Professor Jay Melosh explains that the debris ejected from an impact crater follows ballistic trajectories from its launch position. The innermost ejecta are launched first and travel fastest. Ejecta originating farther from the center are launched later and move more slowly. The ejected material can form a system of rays and secondary impacts radiating from the impact point, as illustrated by this impact crater on Mars with a diameter of 30 meters. Now, suppose that the crater is covered with water so that the crater is no longer visible. Will we be able to figure out the location of the impact from the orientation of the secondary features made by the rays? This is the situation that we have now. The Carolina Bays and the Nebraska Rainwater Basins are radially oriented toward the Great Lakes. So why aren't these basins recognized as part of the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis? A book titled The Cycle of Cosmic Catastrophes, published by Firestone, West, and Warwick Smith in 2006, actually proposed that the Carolina Bays were formed by impacts. Unfortunately, the book did not provide a consistent definition of the Carolina Bays, and the mechanism proposed for the formation of the bays had many errors that contradicted the laws of physics and thermodynamics. The reason for the omission of the Carolina Bays in Firestone's 2007 paper became clear with the publication of America Before by Graham Hancock. In a letter addressed to Hancock, Malcolm Lecomte admonished him, "You were repeatedly warned that any association of Carolina Bay genesis linked to a discussion of the YDB impact event would likely be harmful to the progress of the YDIH research and to the reputations of its investigators. You may not be aware of the time and energy spent to largely neutralize the distracting effects and hostility created by the early Carolina Bay-related assertions made in the non-peer-reviewed book Cycle of Cosmic Catastrophes. The association of bay impact genesis with the YDIH created an early perception in some scientific communities that the YDB impact research was both unprofessional and bordering on pseudoscientific. Those original, naive bay genesis claims still haunt the research and contribute to hobbling its acceptance as a legitimate research activity for a new generation of scientists." In the same letter, Malcolm Lecomte chastised Graham Hancock for a video presentation where he mentioned the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis along with my proposal for the formation of the Carolina Bays. Lecomte says, "Your presentation, juxtaposing YDIH research with Zamora's claim, certainly endowed them with some unwarranted credibility, but also contaminated the YDIH by association." When I published my paper of a model for the geomorphology of the Carolina Bays in 2017, Malcolm Lecomte, who worked with members of the Comet Research Group, wrote a letter to the editor of the Geomorphology Journal trying to get my publication retracted, but the glacier ice impact hypothesis is still alive and kicking. I suppose that most of my videos are misinterpreted as attempts to contaminate the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis. One of the reasons to avoid the Carolina Bays is because many geologists classify them as relict thermokarst lakes. According to Wikipedia, the Carolina Bays are the remains of previous thaw lakes that originated from permafrost. This is wrong because North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia, where many Carolina Bays are found, never had permafrost even during the last glacial maximum. Thermokarst lakes do not have mathematically elliptical geometry, the raised rims, and the orientation toward the Great Lakes that are characteristic of the Carolina Bays. We can fit ellipses by the least squares method to the Nebraska basins and the Carolina Bays by plotting points along their perimeter. The exact fit of the ellipses demonstrates that these geological features have mathematically elliptical geometry. Thus, we can hypothesize that they are impact structures that originated as inclined conical cavities or penetration funnels, and whose raised rims are overturned flaps that should have inverted stratigraphy. The fact that ellipses are conic sections implies that the Nebraska basins and the Carolina Bays originated as inclined conical cavities. Using an experimental model, we can demonstrate that oblique impacts of ice projectiles on a viscous target produce inclined conical cavities that look elliptical when viewed from above. The overturned flanges become raised rims around the cavity. If we obtain a core sample from the rim of an impact crater, we would find the youngest material in the top layer, followed by older material excavated by the projectile from a deeper layer, and going deeper, we would find the young material that was the surface of the terrain at the time of the impact. In 2012, Ted Bunch and 17 co-authors reported inverted stratigraphy in the rim of a Carolina Bay. At the time that the paper was written, the Carolina Bays were thought to have been formed by gradualistic wind and water mechanisms, so the significance of the inverted stratigraphy was not recognized. The authors write, quote, "The two dates at 107 and 183 centimeters below the surface were used to generate an H-depth model, excluding the sample at 152 centimeters below the surface because of the large magnitude of the H-reversal, that is, older sediments lying stratigraphically higher than younger sediments," end quote. The sample at 183 centimeters below the surface seems to correspond to the surface at the time of the extraterrestrial impact 12,900 years ago. Based on the geometry, the radial orientation, and the inverted stratigraphy of the rims, it is now fairly certain that the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska rainwater basins are impact structures. The glacier ice impact hypothesis uses the laws of physics as the mathematical foundation for calculating the characteristics of the impact basins and the extraterrestrial impact. The conic sections representing the Carolina Bays and the convergence point by the Great Lakes provide the initial conditions for the physics-based model. The bay geometry provides launch and impact angles. Ballistic equations using the distance between the convergence point and the bay provide the speed, height, and flight time of the trajectories. Yield equations correlating energy with crater size provide the mass and volume of the glacier ice projectiles. The energy of the extraterrestrial impact can be estimated by combining the information from all the bays using the law of conservation of energy. The speeds required to launch the ice projectiles from the Great Lakes region to the East Coast vary from 3 to 4 kilometers per second at angles of 35 to 45 degrees. All the ballistic trajectories are suborbital space flights with heights of 150 to 370 kilometers and flight times of 6 to 9 minutes. Since the atmosphere extends only to about 100 kilometers, a substantial portion of the trajectories is in the vacuum of space. Above 35 kilometers from the Earth's surface, the atmospheric pressure is below the triple point of water, and water cannot exist as a liquid. Any liquid water ejected above the atmosphere would have produced clouds of ice crystals that block the light of the sun. Knowing the speed of the ice boulders, we can use scaling laws relating energy to crater size for estimating the mass of the projectiles. The scaling laws in the book by Professor J. Meloche were derived from detonations of chemical explosives and nuclear bombs in the 20th century. An online program by Professor J. Meloche and Ross Beyer calculates that a Carolina Bay with a diameter of 1 kilometer could have been created by an impact of an ice sphere with a diameter of 180 meters traveling at 3 kilometers per second with an energy of 3 megatons. This ice boulder would be about the size of Yankee Stadium in New York. The study of the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska rainwater basins has the potential to overcome the objections of the critics who insist that a crater and shock quartz are the only valid criteria for proving that an impact occurred at the onset of the Younger Dryas cooling event. Unfortunately, my proposal for the glacier ice impact hypothesis is under attack from two fronts. One, the critics who object to any extraterrestrial impact whatsoever and ignore the geometry of the Carolina Bays and consider them to be thermokarst or kettle lakes. And two, the proponents of the Younger Dryas impact hypothesis who think that considering the Carolina Bays will contaminate their research. Further advance in this field will probably stall until all the scientists of this generation are dead and young unbiased minds examine the evidence to try to solve the mystery of the Carolina Bays. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas cataclysm. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.